Welcome back, everyone. I'm Jordan Giesige, and this is The Limiting Factor. Tesla's Optimus robot has captured the imagination of the Tesla community, both in terms of its potential to make life better and easier, and from an investment standpoint, it presents a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for wealth creation. So, I've decided to do a video series that covers the basics of humanoid robots, how we'll train and work with them, and their cost, profit, and scaling potential. That's because even though humanoid robots aren't in my wheelhouse, it's a topic I need to understand. And the best way for me to understand a topic is to spend weeks researching, talking to experts, writing scripts, and collecting and creating slides. So this video series, like the others I've done, is a kind of technical diary and a way to share what I've learned. As usual, I hope you learn along with me, and if I get something wrong or if you have insights that I've missed, please share it in the comments below. Before we begin, a special thanks to my Patreon supporters, YouTube members, and Twitter subscribers, as well as Rebellionaire.com. They specialize in helping investors manage concentrated positions. Rebellionaire can help with covered calls, risk management, and creating a money master plan from your financial first principles. For this video, I'd also like to give a big shout out to Scott Walter. Scott began his journey in robotics 40 years ago as part of his doctoral thesis, and in the past few years, he's made invaluable contributions on X and in interviews on the topic of humanoid robots. As part of my scripting process, Scott helpfully corrected and clarified my understanding of robots. But, as always, any errors in the video are my own. If you're interested in robots, follow Scott on X at GoingBallistic5. To kick things off, why is Tesla and every other robotics company pursuing a humanoid form factor for their robots? At a first principles level, it's because over millions of years, humans evolved into a form factor that's both highly mobile and provides an amazing level of dexterity, which allows for unparalleled manipulation of the environment and tools. But from a more pragmatic perspective, robots will have to navigate a world designed by humans in order to assist them. And so a humanoid design creates alignment between humans and robots, allowing them to work side by side and share tools, work, and living spaces. The alternative would be to manufacture highly specialized robots for every job. So why not do that? In some cases, it does make sense to use highly specialized robots. For example, on a factory line. Each robot on the line performs the same tasks day in and day out. The robots are stationary rather than mobile, and the tasks don't typically require any dexterity. That is, the robots that are used on factory lines are a perfect fit for that job. It would be a waste of money to make those robots adaptable, mobile, and dexterous. The ultimate goal of a humanoid robot, for better or worse, is to replace humans in everything that humans do. For example, someone might purchase a humanoid robot to help them around the house. In the kitchen alone, at one moment the robot could be peeling potatoes, the next it could be putting away groceries, and the next it could be walking outside to take out the trash. After it's finished with the kitchen tasks, or even while it's doing the kitchen tasks, it might also be entertaining or teaching the children. Much like the first iPhone displaced the phone, computer, and dozens of other electronics, humanoid robots are going to increasingly replace a greater number of tasks and jobs that humans normally do. There's a number of different ways to predict which jobs will be replaced first, and we'll get deeper into that later in this series, but let's take a quick look at one by Morgan Stanley. For the bottom-up analysis on screen, they looked through the Bureau of Labor Statistics U.S. employment list, and for each industry, evaluated what proportion of the jobs were physical labor that could be performed by a humanoid robot. From there, they divided the industries into three waves of adoption between 2028 and 2040, based on which industries could make the greatest use of humanoid robots to do physical work. This analysis is helpful to a certain extent because it provides the total number of jobs in the U.S. and what proportion of the labor market is physical and could be replaced by robots. But in my view, it draws an artificial line between physical and non-physical labor. That's because the artificial intelligence models that humanoid robots are going to incorporate are going to be just as adept, if not more adept, at non-physical work than humans, such as providing customer service. We're already at the point where AI can reliably do some fairly complex customer service tasks. And ChatGPT, which opened the floodgates for this capability, was released only 2.5 years ago. In that time, we've seen significant improvements in AI models. By the time humanoid robots are likely to be produced at large scale, which is estimated to be about 4 years from now, AI models and hardware will be far better than they are now, and so will be capable of replacing humans at far more non-physical tasks. That is, I view the focus on physical labor in Morgan Stanley's research as an artificial moat for humans that have non-physical aspects to their jobs. Humanoid robots are designed to replace every type of human labor, both physical and cognitive, and they increasingly will. With all that in mind, why are we now seeing an explosion in humanoid robots? 5 years ago, there were only a few players in the game, and now there are dozens. The answer is that there were a number of technologies that had to come together in the past few decades to make humanoid robots work, such as high energy density batteries, low cost high precision sensors, actuators, and high power efficiency computer chips. But the last major breakthrough required was artificial intelligence. That's because a humanoid robot has to navigate the real world, which is infinitely complex and variable. There's no real way to program the robot for every environment and use case. It's far easier to give it a brain in the form of AI that has a basic understanding of the world and how to navigate it. That makes training much faster and easier, which I'll get into in the next video. With that said, there are still several more hurdles to go to bring humanoid robots to market because they're painfully complex to engineer. Let's take a look at two examples, the hands and hips, which are two of the most complex parts of the robot. Starting with the hips, humanoid robots could use wheels or four legs to get around, but wheels aren't as versatile as legs for uneven terrain, and four legs double the amount of hardware required for mobility compared to a design with two legs. There is, of course, a trade-off with bipedal designs, which is that they're inherently tipsy. When humans walk, we're essentially falling forward and catching ourselves with each step. As a result, walking with two legs smoothly is something that robotics companies have taken years to master. The core of the challenge from a hardware perspective is the hips. To get a robot to not only walk, but also have agility requires designing hips capable of powered rotation, abduction, and flexion. Flexion means moving the leg forward and backward. Abduction means moving it side to side, and rotation means twisting the leg. That's a lot of motors, wiring, and complex geometry packed into a tight space. But when it comes together with good software, as this Kung Fu demonstration shows, the result is eerily human and extremely impressive. However, the job of the hips and legs is just to get the business end of the robot, the hands, where they need to be to do work. Hands are the most difficult and important engineering challenge for humanoid robots. That's because the hands are the primary way the robot will interface with the world, which requires two things. First, they have to be able to conform to any object, or multiple objects at once, and manipulate them. Second, that manipulation requires precise coordination between a number of inputs and outputs, such as resistance, power control, and vision. Due to those complexities, as Elon Musk explained, the hand accounts for around half the engineering effort that's going into their Optimus robot. Why? It has a lot to do with the degrees of freedom of a hand. That is, the number of joints and the movement those joints can perform. That's important because each degree of freedom opens up more tasks the hand can perform and allow the hand to conform to more objects. For reference, a human hand has 21 degrees of freedom, not including the wrist. The metacarpal joints add 1 or 2 degrees of freedom for a total of 21 to 23 degrees of freedom. The original Optimus hand had 11 degrees of freedom, and the next version of the Optimus hand appears to have about 22 degrees of freedom, not including the wrist. That means it has as many degrees of freedom as a human hand. And even more impressively, the newer version of the Optimus hand operates more like a puppet, which is how a human hand functions. What do I mean by that? Typically, a robotic hand has the motors in the fingers or palm of the hand. That's as opposed to a human hand that generates power from the forearm using a series of long tendons and tendon rings called pulleys. Tesla's next generation hand for Optimus will use a similar approach, with cables running through the hand and motors in the forearm. This will allow the fingers to be more fine, dexterous, powerful, and durable. But, of course, it requires far more engineering in areas like tension control to avoid slack and overstretching. However, given that Tesla plans on making tens of millions of Optimus robots, and those robots will have more utility and therefore value if they're more agile and adaptable, it's worth the engineering investment to get it right. And of course, the side benefit of putting so much effort into the hands of Optimus is that some version of them will likely also eventually be used by people with Neuralink implants to operate them as prosthetics that rival the functionality of a human hand. Lastly, beyond the 22 degrees of freedom and the puppet-like design of the Optimus hand, the fingers will also have tactile sensing. That will allow the robot to detect pressure so that it can manipulate objects more accurately than through vision alone, which is useful for grasping pliable or delicate objects. It's possible the fingers will also eventually have temperature sensors, which, when combined with the tactile sensors, will give Optimus a better understanding of the objects it touches through thermal variations. Of course, given that Optimus is still at the prototype stage, the next challenge is scaling and driving down the cost of the robots. And, as we all know, prototypes are easy and production is hard. So, although the fundamental technologies required to build a humanoid robot are now available, which has created a crowded competitive landscape, there's years of grueling engineering ahead to build the machine that builds the machine. What this means is the Cambrian explosion of humanoid robots that we're currently seeing will inevitably result in a mass extinction event. The first companies to get the fundamentals of the robot right, make it useful, and scale it, will have a first-mover advantage that allows them to swallow the bulk of the total addressable market. The rest will never make it to mass production. In my view, the company that's best positioned to mass produce a useful humanoid robot is Tesla, which is why this video series will mostly focus on Tesla. I am, of course, biased because I own Tesla stock, but no one pays me for these videos except for my Patreon supporters, YouTube members, ex-subscribers, and Rebellionaire. As always, my goal is to share information I find useful and be as transparent as possible so you can come to your own conclusions. So why do I think Tesla is the best positioned to take the bulk of the humanoid robot market? First, Tesla was arguably the company that fired the starting gun for AI-driven humanoid robots when they announced Optimus at AI Day in August of 2021. So Tesla has a head start. Second, Tesla has the best real-world AI team on the planet. That's important because the understanding of physics and navigation that's required for their full self-driving software is highly transferable to a robot. Third, Tesla has access to one of the best large language models in the world, Grok, through Elon Musk's control of X and XAI. That's important because it'll allow Optimus to understand and work with humans through language. Fourth, thanks to Tesla's full self-driving cameras and the connection to X, the team at Tesla has a greater access to a larger volume and variety of real-world and linguistic data than any other company in the world. That matters because besides compute, data is the raw material that fuels artificial intelligence. Fifth, on the topic of compute, Elon's data center infrastructure team for xAI and Tesla is far and away the most skilled AI data center team on the planet. They were the first to make over 30,000 GPUs coherent, which means to make the GPUs think as one giant brain. And they're able to bring data centers online in months that would take the rest of their competitors years to bring online. Sixth, Tesla is arguably the best large-scale manufacturing company in the world. I say that because in recent years, they've consistently had some of the highest margins in the most difficult and competitive industry in the world, the auto industry. And seventh, they're vertically integrated on the critical hardware technologies for humanoid robots, such as computer chip design, motor design, battery manufacturing, power management, and much, much more. That vertical integration will contribute to well-designed, low-cost, high-efficiency, and high-performance robots that can be scaled at will. In summary, a humanoid form factor is being chosen for general-purpose robots because it's highly adaptable, and the reason why we're seeing an explosion of humanoid robots in the past few years is because they needed a high-powered brain to operate that body, and the hardware and software is now available to provide that. With that said, humanoid robots are still in the development phase. They still need further optimization of the hardware, further optimization of artificial intelligence for a robotic use case, and more training data to expand functionality. When the development has progressed enough, which appears to be in the next year or two, scaling will begin. To a certain extent, scaling will be a chicken and egg problem, but in my view, one that's relatively easily solved. What do I mean by that? The demand for humanoid robots will be dependent on how many tasks they can perform, but the number of tasks that they can perform will be dependent on how many robots are out there collecting data by performing tasks. The solution to that is twofold. First, Tesla and other companies aren't going to immediately start producing 1 million robots per year. It's going to take several years to hit that production rate. They'll start with 10, then 100, then 1,000 per year, and use each additional robot to collect data and broaden functionality. Second, they can leverage virtual environments to compound the real-world data they do collect by hundreds or thousands of times. However, in my view, the scaling challenge will fundamentally be a manufacturing challenge, and Tesla is more up to that task than any other company in the world. In the next video of my Optimus 101 series, we'll take a deeper look at how Optimus will be trained. If you enjoyed this video, please consider supporting the channel by using the links in the description. Also, consider following me on X. I often use X as a testbed for sharing ideas, and X subscribers, like my Patreon supporters, generally get access to my videos a week early. On that note, a special thanks to my YouTube members, X subscribers, and all the other patrons listed in the credits. I appreciate all of your support, and thanks for tuning in.